mate. How did you like? Where did the journey start for you? What you're doing now?
My journey started 16 years ago. Yeah, I have rheumatoid arthritis, and my journey started with a medication called methylprednisone, which helped me to get better.
Mm.
I was so bad, so scrunched up like this. Mm. They gave me one jab and I felt really good. This is in Tauranga Hospital.
Mm.
Second jab, I felt really good. And then the third jab, I was like Superman. Literally, I could have jumped out the window. Mm. Mm. And then the hospital said, see you later. And then I went home to my mother of my kids, and I couldn't work in those days. And she said, I'm going back to Burger King. And then I was left with the baby. So Nikita was just over one.
Mm.
Levi was 3 months old. And next minute, psychosis kicked in.
Shit.
And I didn't know who the babies were at all. I'm screaming at Levi. Who the hell are you? Who are you? Nikita was grabbing my leg and I'm going, who are you? Who are you? And then it just got worse. So my mum and dad come home. Come to our house.
Mm.
And dad walked in, what the hell's going on? And I just got into the car and I've got to get out of here. So I went over to Mowal, which is Mount Maunganui.
Mm-hmm.
And all I had was half a bottle of water, but I also had 1,000 tablets of prednisone. And I walked up Mowal, got halfway and, you know, drinking the water, got right up to the top, got to the southern end, stood on this boulder and sat down on it, and I got the pills, all of them, and I'd run out of water. So I pissed into the bottle, took the whole lot and drunk all these pills down. And I'm just sitting there and I could see a helicopter coming. Someone knows I've gone missing, coming straight towards me. Yes, thank you, whoever cares. And it comes straight, and it was coming from the Tauranga end.
Mm.
And it just went around. And I went, they don't care. And I stood up, and I was just about to walk off, and I got a text from my bro, Emil. He said, whatever you're doing, don't do it. And then he sent me a picture of my daughter. I was going to kill myself, yeah. And so I rung him. I said, bro, I can't believe I've done this. And he was a ED nurse. And he goes, all those drugs that you've got, bro, all you're going to do is fly.
Mm.
And I was flying anyway from all these bad medications. So I went down to A&E in Tauranga Hospital, and they said, there's nothing wrong with you. And I went, please, I need help. And they went, look, it's all circumstantial stuff, don't worry about it, you know, we'll keep observation on you, and then if it's all right, we'll let you go home. So they said, is someone able to pick you up? And I lied and I said, yeah, absolutely, my dad will sit outside, and this is 2 o'clock in the morning. And I walked out and walked up to Pukahinahina or Gate Pa and sat in the trees, and I saw the battle go on, the Māori warriors, the English brigade and all that, seeing people die, and ended up pissing in my hand because I was getting so dehydrated, and I was just totally freaking out, you know, and ended up getting down after a while and walked back to mine and Shelley's place, and I got into the rubbish bin. because I was too scared to go inside. I didn't want to wake people up. And then Shelley would come to open the rubbish bin, and there I am asleep. What the hell are you doing in there? And I went, help me, please help me. And so we went down to the warehouse on the way to community mental health. And I'm just sitting there, and I'm just, all these people, they weren't looking at me, but I was thinking everyone's looking at me. I just freaked out. Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. And then went to A&E, and they went, oh, you're back again. And
thanks very much.
Yeah, and they said, look, we'll send you over to community mental health. I went over there. I sat in there for hours with Shelley, and I went in, and they said, there's nothing you can do about this. And I said, if you do not help me, I'm going to put my head straight in that fan. And they went, no, you're not. And I went to get up. I was going to do it. Yeah, it had to stop. So it was just, took 2 years to get out of my system. And then I went and worked at New World as a storeman. And this is after running Burger Kings and all that sort of stuff. And then me and Shelley broke up. And because I was just so unwell, you know, went back to mum and dad's, and my mum's, bless your mum, she was totally riddled and disabled from rheumatoid in a wheelchair. And she said, you're not going to sit here for the rest of your life feeling sorry for yourself. What are you going to do? And I went, well, I couldn't do anything physical. I was so bad, you know. And she said, why don't you go and study? And I went, I can't even put a sentence together. And she said, don't ever make an excuse. She said, give me 10 minutes of your life. How dare you? And I went, well, you know. And so she said, why don't you, because I was broke, I had no money, I had no job, I thought I'd lost my kids. And she said, why don't you go and study at the Wānanga, Te Wānanga o Te Roa? And I went, oh no, how am I going to do this? So I went, right. And she goes, you're not sitting here. I'm telling you, do not sit in here. I went, okay, mum, okay. As we do with our mums. And I went there, went into the certificate class. It was free. And I was two males out of 30 other wahine there. And I went, oh, God, you know. And next minute, they said to us, you know, please write a paragraph of why you want to become a social worker. And I wrote it down. And then they said, get up and read it in front of everybody. Well, I got up and I couldn't understand my own writing. And then the kaiko come and read it. And then at the end of it, she said, you will never get your social work degree because your dyslexia is so bad. And I went, I was literally, what else can I do? I don't want to go back to mum's and tell her that. And I just said, I'm going to prove you wrong. I have to. So finished the certificate class, worked harder than everyone, I felt. And then I applied for the degree, and you know, 1,000-word assignments, 3,000-word assignments. 4 years later, I was, because in that time I was a single dad with Nikita and Levi. I was in Housing New Zealand House, you know, supported by mum and dad, but also growing veggies, having the opportunity to be a single dad. Was just amazing, you know. You know, and study was good at that time for my well-being. And so I went, right. 4 years later, I got my degree.
Wow.
You know, I had to work harder than everyone else. The kaiakos or the teachers, they would ring me. Or, Scotty, come in. This makes no sense. I went, great, you know. And they said, you can't hand this in like this, because it's not English. It's no one understands it. So they said, go get someone to help you do it, you know. So I did. I would go to mum and dad's, I would go to my friends, I would go to anyone. Help me write this.
Mm.
Yeah, so it makes sense for you fellas. Yeah, because it already made sense for me.
Mm. Yeah, you knew what you were saying.
Yeah. So, yeah, and I just, 4 years later, walked out with my bachelor's degree in social work.
Wow. Did you find at the time that the study was like a distraction from what was going on in your in your mind?
Yeah. I wanted to, how many times I wanted to kill myself in that time was massive. Yeah. Many a time I would stand in the shower and just go look at it, at the shower head and go, there's a dragon coming out of that. And then, you know, the babies, so I had to get look after the babies, you know, it kept snapping me out of it.
Mm.
You know, and then, you know, it was, my brain was getting used, yeah, for positive things, you know, and the knowledge that I was getting from, because I can't read very well, was like, you know, one of the questions might have been, you know, tell us about the Treaty of Waitangi, you know. So I'd put, you know, tell me about the treaty on a video, yeah. And then if they had writing, I'd just copy and paste it, but then, you know, I would use it in a way that I would get a good mark out of it, you know, and a mark was just a pass. I didn't want to be the top student. I just wanted a pass, you know, and I did. And that was okay. So I ended up going to Australia and working with the Indigenous mob over there in Perth, helping youth between 17 and 24 with groups of up to 40 at a time. And you know, a Wadjila or a white fella, you know, teaching the Indigenous fella something, you know, it's pretty powerful, you know, to be in their presence, you know. But Sudanese kids, every type of youth you could think of, you know, and they were all miserable. They couldn't get jobs, they couldn't, because their maladjustments, which is taking on other people's thoughts, was ruining them, you know. So I'd, you know, they would all come in on their first day. It was a 6-week program, and I'd go, hi everybody, my name's Scotty, and I guarantee you for the first day you're gonna hate me. Which is all good, because at the moment I don't know you, and I think you'll probably piss me off the first day. But I said, if you stay here, I will change your life if you choose it, you know. And they'd go, what's this guy on, you know. And so, you know, get people to I would write on the board, you know, and they go, I'd all be cracking up at my spelling, you know, which broke that barrier. They go, no, you know, he's not a teacher, he's not, I was just a human, you know, just wanting to help people change their thoughts. And so
where did that passion for social work, like, where do you think that originally came from? Because we were talking before, like, I didn't want to say that it's your work, and you said it's your passion.
Yeah.
Where did that really start? Like, can you remember when you first sort of thought, oh, this is what I want to do, and this is where I'm going?
I think growing up with a mum that been disabled, you know, and I've always been a good listener and a good yarner, and, I've been married twice, been engaged, I think, 9 times.
It's a numbers game. You'll get the right one eventually.
But it was about, I've been through so much in my life, and, you know, how many people we go see and you sit there and go, oh, they've just learned it through a book. You know, and I had been through so much in my life to go, actually, I can help people get through it, you know, and especially tāne, yeah? A lot of men in their 50s, you know, that you don't understand. Well, bro, I do, you know? And so I've always had a passion. I worked for a supported employment agency for 7 years, working with people with disabilities, you know, no good at the paperwork, but I could get anyone into work, You look at a marketing department and they can sell that object, yeah, that table, yeah. But you market someone that's in a wheelchair for a job that can't move but still wants the job, yeah. That's a true marketer, yeah, because you are having to see the positives and listen to their story to go, you're amazing. And that's what you say to an employer, yeah. Now that person will bring, if anything, a smile to everyone's face, you know. And so that's it, always grew in me. And that 4 years I've been in the wānanga, and been immersed in Māoridom, and going, yeah, I can do this, yeah. And I've always had a passion to help people just change their thoughts, you know. And so yeah, and it's been massive. It's been a huge honor, and the stories that I've been gifted, you know, have changed my life. But you also got to know who you are, yeah. You got to know that you're okay. You also got to know that it's okay to be who you are. And if someone gives you a terrible thought, and what? You know, you're overweight, you're bald, and you know, all that sort of stuff, yeah? You know, that thought can grow if you're not well. Yeah, you go home, oh my God, that person thinks I'm overweight, and you know, oh, I need to lose weight, instead of going, actually, I'm okay with it.
Yeah.
You know, people sit at home in their beds at 2 o'clock in the morning going, oh, that person said, oh, so overweight. It grows and it grows and it grows to the point where they either get really unwell, you know, or suicide, you know, or their marriage breaks up, they lose their kids, you know. It's amazing how at a workplace, if someone broke their leg, we would support them to go to A&E. But if we got someone unwell in the office, we'll say to them, go home. Yeah? Or what? There's an opportunity to say, actually, how about I support you to go to community mental health? Yeah? To sit with that person. And that's any service, yeah? Any company, you know? You know, the physical of breaking your arm, oh, you get empathy straight away. You know, but if you've got really bad thoughts, you're all right, bro, you go home, yeah, and we'll see you on Monday. You know, instead of going, hey bro, how about I support you and we'll go see the doctor together, yeah, or we'll go sit in the A&E together. You know, even if it takes 6 hours, I'm just prepared to do that.
What you said before was really interesting about you get so a social worker that's learned to be a social worker out of a book. And I can tell, like, you're not one of those people. You've got a natural ability for what you do. That's just from I find that I've picked that up from you really quickly, just from how you talk and how you engage. But then I think you've probably used that education, the social work education, just to amplify what you do to augment it. Would that be fair?
You know, to be, not to be scared, not to be worried about your notes, because a lot of it is about writing your notes when you see whānau and that. You know, I've probably got 4 months of writing to do. Whānau first, no matter what. So when I was up at Mount Eden before, and if that tāne that I was talking to about him changing his life, and he wanted to keep on carry on talking, you would have been the last person I'd be worried about today.
No, absolutely.
Because that tāne, that whānau, is more important to anyone, you know, or to me, you know. And I'm known for that, to be whānau first, and me and my manager are like that, you know. So, you know, anyone can learn anything from a book, you know, but it's about what we do with it,
Totally.
And, you know, it's, you know, I mean, I've sat with psychologists, you know, and I've turned it around on them and they're crying. You know, because I'm going, you look a little bit screwed up after what you just talked about, you know. And it's kapai, you know. I don't, it is what it is. Yeah.
So where did the concept come from for You Okay Bro? Like, where did that start?
Well, because I work for Te Tōanga Whānau as a social worker there, in Greton, in Tauranga. And my boss, Tommy, kapai, said he had a number plate. And I said, I'd love to get a number plate for my car, Tommy. And he goes, you think about it, boy, and we'll pay for it. And I went, cool. So from where we were to back to the office, I'm going, what can I do? I was quite excited about it. And I went, You Okay Bro? And I went,
yeah, that's six letters.
Yeah. So I got back to the office and went straight to the computer, went, You Okay Bro? On the plate thing. Yeah, and it went tick. And I went,
sweet.
Tommy. And boom, within about 3 weeks, I got it back. And straight away. So I've got it tattooed on me as well.
Nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, cool.
And, you know, it's about, can't be that easy, you know. And so I've just kept on going with it. I've grown it in my own way, you know, as you can see by my car. It's my way. And it doesn't need to be pretty, because it opens people up to talk, you know. And so yeah, it's been, you know, how easy it is to go, You're okay, bro.
Yeah, it's three powerful
words. Are you okay, bro?
I think I am, but I don't know. It's, you might be picking up on something, I don't know. But, I think I'm pretty good, and I'm loving sitting here talking to you.
Yeah.
But I actually thought about, before we started today, when I was at home, I was like thinking about like how we were going to talk about and all that sort of thing. And I was like, shit, I wonder if he's actually going to try and, you know, connect with me and see if I've got any issues upstairs.
So the issue is, is there?
I think I'm all right. I know I've got some underlying sort of, I get anxious.
Yep.
I don't like being around big crowds of people.
Yep.
And I had issues with depression and stuff when I was about 17, 18, when my old lady got sick the first time and sort of went off the rails a little bit and, you know, ended up sort of getting depressed about that. And I think, you know, through the years I've been able to, you know, deal with it and manage it and stuff. But I the anxiety is probably the biggest one for me. Like, today's going to be a really neat occasion, and I'm really keen for you to meet a lot of these people out here. But there'll be a part of me that's like, fuck, I just want to go sit in the corner and not have to talk to people. And people might find that a little bit surprising about me, I don't know. But
I'll tell you what, I'm exactly the same. Just hold hands, eh?
We'll hold hands in the corner and be like, don't come and talk to us.
And that's fine,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
And the anxiousness is so real. You know, people look at you and go, what's wrong with you? And you go, and I actually don't want to be here.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's not being rude. It's just that our internal thoughts are going, this isn't safe for me mentally. I'm actually better at home, just watching TV or whatever. Yeah, being around a few people. You know, the spotlight, you know, I can't even go into a supermarket much anymore. When I was really unwell, I needed the kids. You know,
were they like a bit of a shield, like the sort of, oh, dad, they help dad, you out? Dad,
you know. And our anxiety is only a thought. And then we've got to go back to, what is that thought? Where did that thought come from? So to have anxiety, absolutely, it's real. But what is the thought behind that? And that would be an hour with you, my bro. Same as me. No one's actually sat down with me and found out, you know. And I think mine would come back for being scared, when I was scared up in the trees, you know. And that was a terrible thought. So everything comes back to a thought. Why?
Do you consider thoughts and emotions to be the same? Do you guys deal with the emotional side of things?
I deal with everything.
Yeah.
So to have emotion, got to have a thought. here. So I'm scared of, hypothetically, I'm scared of a snake. Yeah, you got to have a thought to be scared of that. Yeah. So you know, in Oz, I wouldn't even walk through the long grass. Yeah. Because I've got these snakes everywhere in this country, yeah. I'm going to get bitten. Actually, I never saw one for 7 years.
Yeah.
You know, so for us to stand out in front of all these people today, yeah, it's like literally having to bury those. Oh God, I'm going to talk to how many people, but also I can't remember names. Yeah. It's just because of my dyslexia, yeah? And that's why bro is so good. Yeah,
it's easy. Solves every problem. Bro or sis?
Yeah. Like, yeah, bro, yes, sis. Yeah. Bro, yes, sis, yeah.
True, yeah.
Because, you know, it's, I see 100 people a month, yeah? And the community and everybody goes, oh, my name's, yeah, and I go, cool, bro. Yeah.
Everyone can just be bro, eh?
Yeah.
Just leave it at that.
Because it's, you know, it's, I'm not going to stress that I can't remember people's names. Yeah. It's just part of who I am. If you get offended by it, that's your issue, not mine.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So it's, it can be, you know, the building sites. Yeah. You know, we all stress about silly little things, you know, instead of going, actually it's okay.
Yeah, it's, sometimes it's hard just to say, just to let things go away and just go, actually it's not that bad. You know, just take a couple of deep breaths and you know, and the issue that I have had or have in the past or whatever has been that you think everybody is thinking something about you, and it's like, they don't give a shit about you. They're not thinking about you, don't worry about it. So it's like, that's gives you a little bit of freedom, you know.
Yeah.
And you end up going, oh, so they're not all thinking about me or talking about me or whatever.
Yeah. Absolutely, and that's where anxiety comes from. I'm worried about what other people are thinking.
Yeah.
I'm worried about that we're bald. Yeah. Or my goatee's grey, or you know, I've got too many tattoos.
Yeah.
Or my car's not flash enough. Yeah. Actually, if you don't like who I am, get out of my life. Because I went to a Rotorua arthritis hospital down there when I was sick, and the specialist said to me, he said, only have people in your life that compliment it, and if they don't compliment it, you don't need them. I went, wow. And it's true. Yeah, I'm what, 52 now, I've got 3 amazing friends, and who are my whānau. I've got my dad, I've got my sister, and I've got all my workmates that are workmates, but I don't need anyone else, because I'm, you know, oh, Scotty this, actually I don't need that headache.
I'm glad you brought that up, because in the day and age of social media and people having followers and following other people, you know, like people on Facebook or Instagram, they go, oh, I've got like fucking 800 friends on Facebook. It's like, in reality, you've probably got fucking no friends or hardly any friends or people that you could genuinely connect with, eh?
Absolutely. You know, and our youth are very pro that, which is great. That's their way of communicating to this day and age. Ka pai, yeah? Problem is, it's when all the negative stuff comes out, yeah? And, you know, it's what, that's where the thoughts come in, yeah? And
like we were saying before, about that thought goes in and it just goes round and round and round and gets bigger and bigger.
Yeah, you know, all my friends have seen it. Yeah, and then I go to school, or I'm going to go to work, or, you know, you stuffed up a job today, you're bloody useless, you know? And then you go into work and going, oh, God, the guys are going to give me shit, and they've got, well, they haven't worried about it, you know? But that grows, you know, and it's so dangerous. But that comes back to the maladjustment stuff. Taking on people's thoughts or growing your own thoughts.
Yeah.
And that's where it becomes dangerous.
Yeah. So that, going back to the concept of you okay, bro, like, so you, get in your car, you'll drive, you'll park up somewhere, put the signs out, and people will just come up to you. That's as simple as it works.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You know, so driving from Tauranga yesterday, I left there about 10:30, and I drove all the way up. I went through Matamata onto State Highway 2 to come to Auckland, and there's a big Hauraki sign, and I pulled over, got my two signs out, banged them up down the road, and put my two seats there, and that whole time, truckies were going past, because I just bought a CB radio, never used one before, and I thought, I want to connect with everybody. There's a massive amount of mental health and methamphetamine use in the trucking industry at the moment. You know, and so I thought, right, don't know how to use it. Hi, I'm Scotty. If you guys need to have a yarn, you know, pull over. And then all these trucks and everyone's beeping, tooting, and all that. People are driving past, smiling. You know, and I'm thinking, that's how easy it is to put a smile on someone's face, even if it's for a minute or 10 seconds.
Yeah.
That person has smiled. And it could have been the first time they smiled today, you know. And then went right, there was no trees around, so the old ball head was getting rather cooked.
Yeah, I can sympathize, I know all about that. You need a good bucket header or something like that.
And I went, where am I gonna go? So I went right and went, okay, got up to the freeway or the motorway, and I went, okay, I'm gonna go down Mary Mary Way. Is there a side road somewhere? Or, and there wasn't, so I went up by, there's a big racetrack down there somewhere.
Hampton Downs,
and, and went down and went through, right, and I sat outside Mary Mary Raceway, and there's a sign saying motorway or expressway ends here. So I got the sign just beside it, behind it, and I put the car behind it, and I just sat in this big grass area. And people were smiling, tooting, and I'm just sitting there going like this to the truckies, like that. And that was cool, you know. And it's, you know, because it's got "Are you okay, bro?" on the signs, they'll be thinking about that. Yeah. And the power of thought again. Yeah, actually, I'm not good, you know. You know what? You know why have I done 18 hours today? Actually, I'm not too good. Yeah. Next minute, he may be asking someone for help. Maybe he'll get home to his wife or the wahine as well. You know, the bro-esses. Yeah. You know, I need help. Yeah. Why? Oh, I saw this fella. You know, it's all, you know, mental health awareness stuff. You know, was out there. I saw him on the news. I've seen him on TikTok or whatever. You know, it opens a conversation.
Man, I can't help thinking about what you said before when you were sitting on that rock on the Maunga there. And your mate texted you as you were about to
jump off.
You think, like, any time that you do what you do, you're potentially doing that for someone. You know, and that fuck, that blows me away. Like, I mean, I get a bit teary about that. Just to have that, sorry, just have that little moment where you can, you know, impact someone's life and just stop them. Sorry. That's cool.
You know, it's, we make things too complicated for people. You know, from here, from this office, I don't know Auckland. How far is it to community mental health?
Man, I'd have no idea.
No.
No idea. I'd say if you go towards the hospital, you probably find some, you know, and that's a couple of Ks, but I'd have no idea.
No one knows.
No.
You know, you're waiting 3 weeks for a doctor. You know, but I can be that person to sit. My goal is that bus. Sit outside your office. Could be one day. I don't know how many people in this whole building. There could be 100 people working here. Yeah, there'd be at least 20 people that are unwell with their mental health.
Is it that high?
Yeah.
Shit.
You know, and it would be higher. Yeah, but it would be a lot of circumstantial stuff in that year, but it would be massive amount of mental health. Yeah. And it's scary to think that we keep on promoting people driving home.
Yeah.
You know, I love the thought of sitting there and listening to someone telling me, Scotty, you've just saved me from killing myself. And I go, that's fine. You're not leaving here, yeah, until we've yarned this out. So I was down at Te Puna, where I was doing it every Sunday. 82-year-old, yeah, and I'm sitting under the tree, and he's biking along, Pākehā guy, and he goes, what's this all about, boy? And I went, oh, it's about mental health. And he goes, he goes, oh, you know, my age, we're too hard for that. We get all through it. We've been through enough in our life. And I went, oh, okay. I said, and how's everything else in your life? And he went, well, my wife's got 3 months to live. She's dying of cancer. I went, oh, sorry to hear that, mate. And he said, my daughter's coming over from England. And she's going to spend the rest of the time with her mum. I went, well, and I said, you know what? He said, all the people coming to support her and help her and all that. And I said, and how are you, bro? And he just burst out crying.
Yeah.
He said, no one's asked me how I am.
And
I went, well, how are you? 45 minutes later, he's just telling me everything. And I said, look, mate, I'm here for you. Yeah, I'll be here. If you see my car, flick your lights, I will pull straight over. Yeah. And he said, thank you. You're a good young man, he says, you know. And he said, you know, we need more of this. You know, I mean, those old codgers, you know, my dad's sort of the same age, they're not going to talk.
No.
You know, they're hard men.
Yeah. But yeah, so you managed to just connect with him just for that little bit, and then the floodgates opened, eh?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he said, I haven't cried for years, boy, he says. You know, and I said, well, it's a privilege for me to sit here and listen to your story. And he said, I said, and what are you going to do, you know, when your wife passes? And he goes, I've got trips organised. I want to go down the South Island. And I said, well, you know, that'll help you, you know, with your thoughts, you know, and keep you busy. And they've been married for 60-odd years, you know. And I said, that's, you're going to miss her. And he got upset again, you know, because it was the love of his life.
Yeah.
You know, and I've had gang members pull up, you know. Hey, bro. You know, he jumped over the fence. You know, bro, I've been, the meth, you know, I want to get out of the gangs, you know, I don't know what to do, you know. And I go, well, what would you say to your two boys that you've got? And they were going to be gang members. And he said, you know, you don't want to do that, bro, but if you do it, you know, don't do this and the whole pile of stuff. I said, you just answered your own question, my bro.
Yeah. Absolutely. When someone pulls up and has a chat with you, I'd imagine a lot of the time it get pretty heavy. Like, you must hear some pretty full on stuff. Do you feel that weight when someone unloads on you, or do you just? But and then sorry, there's two questions here. First, do you feel that weight? But then, how do you also decompress or? Get back to your sort of ground zero type thing. World. Yeah.
So, every person that talks to me, and I've got it all documented, and it's part of my. But I just sit there and go, it's their issue. To be a good social worker, you can't take people's issues on because otherwise you'll end up in the ward.
Yeah.
You know, so it's telling us their story, whānau story, that's their issue. Yeah. I can't take it on, which is ka pai, because I can't be a good social worker being as crazy as some of the people that I've seen,
yeah.
Because it's dangerous for them and for me, you know. So, you know, it's about, okay, I'll make sure that you're well. I'm going to help you find hope, whatever that is. Yeah. And then the second thing is that my well-being is sitting under a tree with a sign going, are you okay, bro? Yeah. So, you know, because it's, you're only talking to someone like you and me are doing right now. Yeah. And if these mics weren't here, it'd be just having a yarn.
Yeah.
You know how hard, it's not time consuming. It's not hard. It's just, how are you, bro? Yeah. And then, you know, yesterday by the Hauraki district sign, no one stopped. Yeah. So I had an hour and a half just sitting there by myself, having my cup of coffee, having my ciggies.
Yeah.
You know, oh, downtime.
Yeah.
You know, and people tooting, and it's like, hey, bro, you know.
It's like a win-win. If someone did stop, you help them. If someone doesn't stop, you're like,
yeah,
cool, bit of downtime, like you say.
Absolutely, you know, which keeps me well. You know, I haven't been unwell for about, how long I've been back in New Zealand? 3 years. I haven't been unwell for about 4 years.
Nice.
Really bad, yeah.
I
keep on getting sick every sort of 4 or 5 years. It just comes on. So, but no, I've been really well at the moment, and knowing that it's their issue keeps me well.
That's real good to hear that you've been good for 4 years, and
yeah.
you know, hopefully that those periods in between get longer and longer, eh?
Yeah.
Do, when you're talking to someone,
yeah,
do you feel like you always have to have an answer for them, or do you just listen and just say whatever comes into your head and you just listen?
You know, I a guy the other couple of weeks ago, I want to kill my wife.
Shit.
Why? Because I'm really unwell. I think she's having sex with someone. And I said, okay, let's break this all down. You're not going anywhere, otherwise I'm taking you to the police station, bro. You know, how long have you been doing this? You know, how long have you been hurting her? Years, bro, years. I said, if you don't do something about it, yeah, and if you're gonna hurt her before we leave here, yeah, I'm taking you to the police station. And we broke it all down, yeah? And I sorted out him going to the domestic violence group thing in Tauranga, yeah? And got some other services involved. But yeah, he wanted to kill her.
Shit.
And that was only his thought, she hadn't been.
Yeah.
Yeah, oh, she's back. She goes to work and all that sort of stuff. And I said, well, you know, maybe she's trying to make more money for you. Oh, I didn't even think about that, bro.
That must have, and you think like thoughts like that must come from something that he's experienced maybe in his upbringing. That's
exactly
or,
what's happened. Yeah. He lived with domestic violence all his life and had normalized it. You know,
that's that word, that normalization thing. That's massive, man. Like, you must see a lot of that. You know, the like we were saying before, that people haven't chosen to break that cycle of behavior and it's just become normal to them.
Absolutely. Yeah. So probably the powerfulest one I'd ever seen was when I was in Australia, and it was a young transgender, sorry, a girl transgendering to a man, yeah? And he came into the class, yeah? And he hated everyone, and he sat in the corner. Yeah, and I said, you know, I tried to engage with her, with him, sorry, and we were talking and didn't want to engage, and I said, right, everyone go home. And then he come back in the next day with everybody, and he had this big bandage on. And I went, what's wrong? And he said, you made me cut myself. And I went, what? And he said, all those things that you were saying for us to change our life and all that sort of stuff, I got home and I cut myself. And I went, life, fuck. Excuse my language. Yeah. And I said, how dare you? And he goes, you know, it's been my journey of life and all that sort of stuff. And I went, I hear what you're saying, but don't blame me.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
I said, secondly, do you want to die?
Mm.
And he said, yes. I went, right, hold on a second. I went down to the work kitchen, got the biggest knife in there, walked straight in front of everybody, walked straight into the desk, grabbed the knife and went smack straight onto the desk. I said, if you're going to do it right now. You want to die? Yeah. And he just burst out crying. He said, I don't want to do it. I said, well, stop lying.
Mm.
You can be the most amazing person. Yeah. I said, I'm here to listen to you. And then he says, over a couple of days, he says, Scotty, I need to tell you something. And I went, what? He had cut every part of his body from privates everywhere. Not one part of his body was not cut. And I went, you're fucking incredible. I said, you are the most resilient person I've ever met. I said, what, you've been through the sexual abuse and all that sort of stuff? And I said, you know what? What do you want to do in your life? And he says, I want to be a transgender counsellor, but I want to sort out my own facility for just transgender people. And I went, cool.
Mm.
I said, do it. Well, I can't, I've got no money. I can't because I've got no support. I said, you're right here, right now. I said, I want you to draw what your facility will look like. So we drew it, you know, over a couple of weeks.
Mm.
And it was amazing. I said, right, now I want to see it in 3D. I said, this is your passion. I'm going to make sure you do it.
Mm.
Yeah? Before you leave here, I want you to see your vision.
Mm.
So we did it. And then at the end of it, he came up and gave me a big hug. Thank you, Scotty, thank you. And 6 months later, the new year, come in and he had applied for the counselling course at like the Polytech over there.
Mm.
And he's still there.
Wow.
You know, he's pretty much finished now. Mm. I still contact with them. You know, and he's changed his life. He's working with all these transgender kids.
Mm.
But it's just about giving someone hope.
Yeah, yeah.
You're, before you're a transgender person, before you're anything, you're a human being.
Mm.
You, if you want to be the president or the prime minister of New Zealand, do it.
Mm. Mm.
But it's going to take work to get there.
Mm.
And if you can't read, if you can't write, it doesn't matter. Yeah, you've got to ask people, how can I do this?
Mm.
And it's the same out on the road. Yeah, someone comes in, oh, my mental health's really bad. What does it look like? How does it feel? How does it smell? You know, and they go, what?
Mm.
I said, there's a certain smell, you know? And people go, wow. I didn't think about it. Close your eyes. You know, what does it feel like? You know, and you know, there's so many 50-year-old men out there that are single.
Mm.
You know, and wahine, yeah, because they're so lost.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. Do you think that the people that are like sort of suffer the most tend to be like they're lonely or they're just isolated or you know, they don't have someone to talk to? Because I guess a big reason why people are resonating with you is because they've found someone that will listen to them and they will just sit with you and download and you know, it just even just doing that must just feel like the fucking best thing they've ever done. You know, like, is it about, are people lonely, do you think, or they just don't have anyone to talk to?
Well, lonely is a thought. I drive all the way from Tauranga to here, yeah, and I don't normally listen to the radio,
mm.
but I'm not alone. You're only alone if you think about it. Yeah. You know, and it's a powerful thing to say that I'm alone. Yeah. It's what you do with it if you let that grow.
Mm.
Oh, I'm alone. Oh my God, you know, oh, I'm going crazy here. You know, sitting on the throne every morning. Oh my God, looking at the toilet door going, oh geez, I'm feeling really unwell. You know, no one's, someone get me the toilet roll, or there's no one to get the toilet roll type thing, you know.
Yeah.
I'm going crazy, yeah. You know, so instead of going, actually, I'm okay being alone, yeah. And but you can be, you know, people say being in jail, you need to be in a jail like this, yeah.
Mm,
mm. Actually, the mind is the most powerful jail you can ever have, yeah. Yeah. Mm. And you know, a lot of the guys that I talk to, I've said to them, I've been in my jail, yeah. I've never been to jail,
mm.
And I have no intentions to go, but I've lived in it in here,
mm.
you know. And it's not until I've broken that thought that I've got out of it, mm. yeah. And it's a scary place.
Yeah,
you know.
I guess that's, you know, why they have that solitary confinement in jail. Like,
yeah.
You know, you're obviously in a little room by yourself, but yeah. The real jail is the one that's doing your head in.
Absolutely.
When people sit down and talk to you, because you said yeah. before, like you said, 100 people a month or something like that.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
fucking amazing.
Yeah.
When do you see the same? Are they the same people? Like, and I mean that by personality traits, or do they have the same issues, or do you see the same sort of person always rocking up to have a yarn with you?
It can be going to New World.
Yeah.
And a lady sitting there going, oh, I love your car. And I go, how are you?
Mm.
Oh, I'm great, dear.
Mm.
You know, but the next time I go, it's a guy getting out of his car. Oh, I like your car, bro.
Mm.
You know. How are you, my bro? Yeah, haven't been too well at the moment, bro. Oh, grab a seat, man. Mm. You know, or should we just have a yarn?
Mm.
Oh, yeah, bro. You know, and we're talking about stuff. You know, it could be 5 minutes.
Mm.
Yeah. You know, come down and see me if you see my car. You know, I'm parked up anywhere on Sunday.
Mm.
Yeah, come out and see me, bro. Oh, thank you, bro. You know, so that adds up. You know, stopping at the dairy or getting fish and chips. You know, and someone comes out and watches reads the bonnet of my car.
Mm.
You know, oh, what's this all about? You know, about mental health. And, oh, and I go, how's your mental health?
Mm.
Well, actually, it hasn't been too bad at the moment, actually. Oh, how have you kept well?
Mm.
Yeah? So you're reinforcing, oh, it sounds great, you know. But then you'll get that one person that'll go, I'm not well. Right. Let's pull the seats out.
Mm.
You know, we'll jump in my car. Yeah.
Can you see it in them?
Like, yeah, you can see it in people's eyes.
Yeah.
You know, and you can. I'm an eye person, so I can tell if someone's unwell. Yeah. And I saw it today with that tane up, and went, well, you can see that you're hurting. But he gave me a hug.
Mm.
You know, and I thought, wow, you're giving me that. I've only known you for 5 minutes and you gave me a hug and saying thank you.
Yeah.
You know, what a privilege to be in that space with him for that 5 minutes, for him to tell me a little bit of his story, to say that being off meth and all that. So, oh, wow.
Mm.
You know, and you know, being told that, you know, when I was out at Glenview's Glenfield Road, is it?
Oh, yeah.
Glenfield Road, and I was sitting there.
Mm.
And a lady walked past with her dog. And she goes, hello, dear, how are you?
Mm.
And I said, I'm good. And she goes, there needs to be more people like you. And I went, why? And she goes, because there's too much mental health around.
Mm.
And I thought, wow, here you are, you haven't even spoken to me, and you're telling me, you know, look at what the car's done.
Mm.
Yeah. And I was just sitting there, you know, and I thought, what a privilege. You know, you're telling me that there should be more, so why isn't there?
Mm.
You know, why is there not cars, buses, everywhere, you know. I was in Raglan 6 weeks ago, yeah. And I got asked to go over there to work with the Raglan area. There's been a few suicides over there. And then I talked to the community. Yeah, we did a big workshop of the maladjustments. There was 20 people in there. By the end of it, they're going to start your own yarn seat.
Nice.
Yeah. You know, they're going to have a community yarn seat where if someone's sitting there, you got to yarn. How are you? You know? And it's, you know, that booth that you've got down there.
Yeah.
I'm going, wow, that is so cool. Idea. That could be the youth, the yarn
booth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, to go, actually, when you're in someone's space, you know, people go, oh, but are you okay? You know, Doctor Who?
Yeah, well, the TARDIS, yeah, that's right. Yeah.
You know, and people stand in there and probably feel more safer, yeah, than what they would be with 50, 60 people standing in there.
Yeah, easy. You know? Sure. Yeah.
And so... It's been a massive journey, and you know, I was down the Petone, yeah, with my car. A lady come up, talked to me about her mental health. I've been to Castle Point, yeah, to go and see our family were brought up there. And a guy come up, talked about his mental health, I've been in Rotorua and all these Māori kids come up, oh bro, this is the coolest car, what's this about? And oh, it's about mental health. And oh, my dad, bro, he's really unwell. I said, look, here's my number. If dad needs a hand, get him to give me a ring. Oh, cheer, mātoko, you know. And it's just amazing, you know, to be given an opportunity to get out to the community.
Yeah.
Yeah. An Indigenous man, when I was in Australia, he said to us in the room, he said, why do we have to come to you? Why can't you come to us? You've got all the money. And I've held on to that going, he's so right. You know, and then when COVID hit, you know, the government said, you can't talk to each other, next door neighbour and all that, yeah? So I went, right, Levi, I'm a social worker, I need to talk to people, yeah, making sure they're okay. So that we went straight out, painted the car, are you okay? Yeah? You know, put some statistics. So when we went up to the supermarket, because that was our life in those days, yeah. You know, I thought, okay, so I would drive past and people would crack up because all the wheels are painted and that. And I'd drive up and people would smile and then someone wouldn't be smiling. And I'd stop and I'd get out of the car and go, you're okay? Yeah, I'm all right. I said, look, I'm going to park over there in that car park. You stand on that side of the car. I'll stand on this side of the car and we're going to yarn.
It's as simple as that. Has anyone ever, and don't take this the wrong way, but has anyone ever told you to fuck off? Like, if you've come to them and said, are you okay, bro? They said, oh, fuck off. You know, has there been any negative to it? Because I'd imagine, like, it's you're reaching out to help someone.
Absolutely.
And 99 people out of 100 are probably going to say, yeah, I need some help. What, is there that one person who's
just, never.
Really?
Never.
Like, that's amazing.
Yeah. The Kitty Kitty Facebook page. They did the segment on my it was in the Herald, and the guy that runs the paper said that he had never seen so many posts that were positive.
Wow.
You know,
because if people are going to pile on something, they'll do it on Facebook, the keyboard warrior thing, you know. So
absolutely. And no. I've had people go drive past and go, oh, you bloody idiot. And I've gone, yeah, absolutely, bro. Thank you.
Thanks. Yeah.
And then the next car will be cracking up.
Mm.
You know, my t-shirt's got the stigma finger. Yeah. And it was only last week at work actually, and a lady said, "That is so offensive." I went, "Absolutely it is."
Mm.
I said, "You know why? Because you've already started talking to me." And she goes, "What is it about?"
Yeah.
And I said, "You know, it's about stigma, about mental health and all that." And she goes, "Well, why would you have it a finger like this?" And I said, "Come with me, I'll show you."
Mm.
And we walked out the door and I showed her the car and she just burst out crying.
Mm.
She goes, "Oh, I didn't realize, oh, I'm so sorry." I said, "Don't be sorry." Yeah, it started a conversation, this t-shirt.
Mm.
And then she said, "I've lost a couple of my friends to suicide. I lost my brother to suicide." And then she's written on the right-hand side, on the passenger side, "Hope."
Mm.
Yeah. 15 minutes before, she had never met me before.
Mm. Mm.
And here she is telling me that people are suiciding in her life, you know? Wow. Mm.
Like you, that word you keep saying, like privilege, eh? And it is a privilege to connect with people so quickly,
yeah,
and for them to be so open. You know, that's a hell of a privilege, I think.
Well, you know, you look at counsellors or psychologists or something like that. That costs $100 and something. Some are $300-$400. You know, so you know, and then the first time you go in there, it's sort of like, who am I? What am I doing? You know, mm. So. 45 minutes of that is telling you about yourself, yeah. So there goes the first $300, yeah. Mm.
You cut straight to the chase, though, are you? Like, you ask the question straight off the bat.
Absolutely. Well, the car asks the question.
Yep.
Yeah. You know, the car says, "Are you okay?"
Mm.
You know, and then I don't have to build a relationship.
Mm.
Yeah. Because part of social work is building a trustful relationship. Yeah. People won't trust you to open up really big, yeah. So that car straight away breaks all those barriers down to go, "Oh, bro, what's this all about? Yeah, why have you painted your wheels? Oh, it's all about mental health, bro. Oh, true." And then I go, "You okay, bro?"
Mm.
"Well, actually, bro, no, I'm not." "Oh, come on, bro, let's go and have a cup of coffee, yeah?"
Mm.
"Oh, true, bro. How much does it cost?" "Nothing."
Mm.
"We're just going to have a yarn."
You know? And do you find more, is it mainly men? Or is there
actually more wahine.
Wow.
Yeah. A lot of wahine engage, which is great.
Mm.
But they're doing it because of their husbands or their sons or, you know, their brothers, sisters, you know. What can I do? What tools can I use, you know? And I go, "Well, the first tool was that you could bring them to me." Yeah. And they go, "Oh, okay, well, you'll be here." "Absolutely." Yeah. Or I'll give them a tool about, you know, seeing your life through the eyes of a pumpkin. Yeah.
Hmm.
And they go, "Well, what do you mean by that?" Get them to draw what your life looks like through an eye of a pumpkin, or the eyes of a pumpkin. And people just go, "Whoa." You'll see, I've got pictures up on my office wall of youth stories, and you'll soon see what people's lives are.
Wow.
Yeah. You know, how many are here today? You imagine saying to them, this isn't about us, this is about you. Here's an opportunity to show us what your world looks like through the eyes of a pumpkin. Yeah. And I did that down in Ragland, you know, and one of the ladies just cracked in front of everybody. They didn't know that she had been going through hell. She didn't know anyone in there. She was isolated. Next minute, the whole community is supporting her.
Mm.
And she's got someone to talk to now. And that was just from looking through the eyes of a pumpkin.
Yeah, well, such a simple concept, eh?
Yeah.
Yeah, and just to be able to, you know, draw out that emotion and that thought from people to, you know, so that they open up.
Yeah.
Why do you think, like, what is it about humans or human nature where we don't want to talk about it? Like, what is it about us that makes us go, "Oh, no, I'm fine. You know, I don't need to talk about it." From old school to, like, where we're at now. It's changed a lot, eh?
Well, you know, you talk about our kurus and our elders saying, you know, and people still do it now, you know, harden up, get over it, you know. I think it's just people are opening up more than they used to. Our kids are the ones that are going to just talk about it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's us, you know, 40, 50, 60-year-old tāne and wahine that have still got that stigma of not talking about it. You know, I can't talk about it in the workplace. I don't want people to think I'm an egg. You know, they talk about, you know, mental health day, you know. You know, I need a mental health day. Okay, so when you come back in on Monday, yeah, we'll have a talk about your performance. Why? Why didn't you go, that person is needing a mental health day? I'm coming around and we're going to talk and maybe I take you to community mental health because I'm going to support you. Yeah, you know, so people are too scared to do that.
Yeah.
Because they're getting judged. Oh, Scotty took a mental health day because he's been sick, you know, and they go, oh, what's wrong with him? He was fine yesterday. Actually, I've been sick right through the whole week overthinking stuff and I've been awake till 4 o'clock in the morning and I can't work. Okay, well, you have the day off. We'll see you on Monday. Okay, well, that person has just given you that doorway to say, actually, I'm actually really unwell. I need a mental health day, and we go, all good. We'll pay you some sick leave or annual leave instead of going, actually, I'm going to come around and support you through this. Oh, don't worry. And that is a culture. If you know, people going, he's just having a, you know, a sickie. You know, actually, if they use that word mental health day, there's an opportunity to help someone. You know, and it's you know, it's become a bit of a tokenistic type of thing. Oh, we'll give you that mental health day. It's all in our contracts. I've got it in my contract. I've never used it. But I'm just, some days I just can't do it. I don't want to go to work. But then some days my mental health is, can be bad. I've thought about something, or you know, I haven't written all my notes, and I'm thinking, oh no, I've got to get behind. And that's having great communication with the my manager is amazing. She goes, Scotty, you're getting quiet. What's wrong?
She can see, pick up on the cues in that. He understands your little signs that, you know, something's not quite right.
You know, and but we always wait until someone's unwell, you know. And I see it out on the road, you know, and I'm thinking, I wish I could jump in the truck with those guys. You know, you know, and you know, you talk about like the main freights and all that sort of stuff where it got massive amount of drivers, you know, and you know, imagine a car like mine sitting out front of the gateway, you know, if the drivers see it, you know, and the bosses know, okay, Mike's getting unwell, you know, he's had a few days off. Hey, why don't you go over and see that fella over there? Just to go and have a yarn, you know. You know, you talk about $1 million companies or whatever, why don't we have a mental health worker in there?
Well, that idea that you said about having someone in one of their trucks.
Yeah.
Bloody hell, because they're sitting there driving.
Yeah.
You just, man, you could you'd change someone's life in a, you know, a couple of hours sitting on a trip driving.
You know, and it could be that every company has a mental health actual worker, you know, and goes to everyone every day and just toddles around with them. Because you can still work, and when people are working, they will talk about, you know, driving from here A to B is the best time to do an assessment. Because they're concentrated on the road. How are you getting on? The missus is pissing me off, or my husband's pissing me off, you know. And it's the best place. I did an assessment 2 weeks ago with a homeless guy. And then he had a massive seizure. Because he was an alcoholic. I went, bro, we're going to community meeting. Actually, we're going to A&E now because you're having a seizure. You know, so.
And he's all right now?
he's sort of an alcoholic.
Yeah.
And he's, I said, if, you know, with people that are addicts, I say to them, if you were a good addict to methamphetamine, or if you're a good alcoholic, yeah, you'd be dead.
Mm.
So you must suck at it. So why are you doing it?
Yeah, true.
Yeah, yeah, because that is the outcome, that you will end up dead.
Mm.
So, and they always say, I don't want to die. Okay, well, why are you doing it?
Mm.
And then they go, ooh, I don't think about it like that, bro. Absolutely.
Mm.
You know?
And that's the power that you've got with your approach, I think, is, you know, just that ability to relate to people so quickly and, you know, from a genuine place.
Yeah.
Like talking before about the people that learn it out of a book, to me, they'll do a okay job, but they will never sort of get to the heart of the issue like you can with your approach and just being genuine and being and listening.
Yeah.
You know, because that's the key in my world is your ability to listen and then, you know, provide some solutions and stuff.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You know, and being straight up with people, you know, and, you know, guys that have been doing domestic violence, and I'll say to guys, you know, and this can be gang guys, you know, and I'll say to them, what would you do if I was beating your missus up, or your kids up, I would kill you. So what's the difference? She's a mother, she's a daughter. What's the difference, bro? Oh, I didn't think about it like that, bro. Okay, let's change it. You know, and, you know, it's about just being truthful with people. You know, the gang members, the guys that think they're too staunch, you know, for anything, actually, you're just a human being, man. And I've worked with some of the biggest, hardest guys you could think of, you know, and then within 10 minutes I'm sitting there crying, you know, because, you know, it's just about why. You know, you know, if you want to be a good gang member, we'll do it well. But be a good, nice gang member. Do something for your community, you know, people do look up to you, you know, so, and, you know, stop the meth and all that sort of stuff. Oh yeah, I can do that. We'll do it. You can even be a social worker if you wanted to. We'll be a youth worker, you know. You know, and so it's just changing people's thoughts.
And I think you're clearly doing that one person at a time, and you know, it's just part of the reason why we wanted to get you in today was to meet you and, you know, to hear your story and you know, and start to spread that word around our team and, you know, some of our client base and stuff. And, you know, no doubt there'll be a few people that'll come up to you tonight and probably, you know, and do what we've been talking about here today, have a download. You know, might be a few tears out there today. You never know. But, mate, I thank you for what you do. It's not much coming from someone like me, but, mate,
so yeah, we just want to support you. You just put yourself down.
Yeah, I did. Yeah.
So change all that wording.
Yeah.
Say it again.
Mate, yeah, just thank you for what you do. I won't say the other part because I actually didn't really mean it. I was just like, just wanted to say thanks for and all the people that you help, you know. It's a massive thing that you do just to be able to sit there and listen to others and, like I said before, to be that person who's potentially stopped someone from taking that step or taking that pill or whatever, you know, that to me, that's dare I say, God's work. It's you know, you're doing the work that a lot of people wish they could do. So you just keep it up, man. We'll do what we can tonight to support you. And
thank you, my bro.
Awesome.
You know, thank you for people trusting me. You know, it's not only an honour and a pleasure, but, you know, there's a need and there's a want out there, and if we keep on telling people to go to community mental health, if we keep on telling people to go see a doctor, which takes 3 weeks, and it's amazing how much funding goes into those places, you know, here I am, a 52-year-old man, that wants to get to the community and sit there, but can't get funding, yeah, to get a bus, to be able to sit there and go to a farmer's house and then sit in the middle of, say, Marakopa, which has got no community, sit there for a week, sleep in the bus, do some mental health work there, not cost them anything, and then go, right, I'll be back in a couple of months, but I'll make sure before I leave there that everyone's okay. You know, and go, right, I'll be back, and if there's some really unwell people there, right, get in the bus, we go, I'm taking you to community mental health. You know, because it can be that easy. And that's my goal. It's going to happen. I've just started my charitable trust, which is all the paperwork's just started, and we just signed off on it. You know, and you know, saving one person pays for everything.
Absolutely.
Yeah. You know, and now that I've got the charitable trust started stuff, you know, hopefully I can get some funding, and you know, it was interesting to think. If I was to go between Wellington and Picton, there's 25 trucks on there. And if I had a sign that sat in the middle of all those seats and go, come and have a yarn to me, bro. Yeah, there's a 3.5 hour trip.
Yeah.
I could do half of those, work with half of those guys on that ferry.
Mate. Yeah. Hey. Yeah, so good.
You know, and keeps them well, keeps them focused. You know, guys and wahine that are drivers, yeah. Then get off there, you know, and, you know, go to the middle of, I've never been to the South Island, but just go to the middle of nowhere. How is everybody? Because, you know, if you can't afford the petrol, you know, to get from the middle of nowhere to see a doctor, and when it's costing $60-$70 to see a doctor, what do people do? You know, they stay at home.
Yeah.
You know, so, I mean, it's, someone said to me the other day, you cannot do it all over in New Zealand. Absolutely I can.
Of course you can. Yeah.
You know, someone's just got to start it. Yeah. And I was talking to one of our senior social workers the other day, and she said, and my manager said, oh, Scotty's out of here soon. Yeah, because he's going to get his bus. And, she goes, I knew you would do that. And she said, and it's needed. You know, and I'm going to do it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I believe
it. And by it'll be that bus is my goal to get, instead of taking the Toyota, which is, she's a good old Toyota, very reliable as they are. But I think in a bus, you know, I can go anywhere and everywhere, but have three, I can run a group in it. Yeah. But then I can sleep somewhere instead of costing $250.
Yeah, staying in a motel.
Yeah. You know, I've got my bed, I've got my, it's just one big, huge mental health bus. Yeah. But why can't I get funding for it? Yeah, because I'm, you know, not good enough, or I'm a registered social worker.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's where I think it's about raising the awareness and, you know, like, what we'll do tonight, we'll try and, you know, get some bloody donations happening and, get you on that track, man. So, yeah, mate, appreciate you coming in, man. Really appreciate it.
Thank you, my bro, and you take care,
Cheers, mate. Thanks.
Okay. Cheers.